The Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center is now investigating this week's GCash incident, where some GCash users were targeted in unauthorized transactions. Lady Vicencio has more on the developments.
20 complaints have been filed before the Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center regarding unauthorized cash transfers of GCash users. CICC Undersecretary Alex Ramos says the return of the funds to affected users does not mean the issue has been resolved.
Some form of unusual activity or out of the ordinary na hindi tama o hindi angkop sa sistema, that is already some form of hacking, whether it's kaninong device yan.
Ramos says the CICC has invited GCash to explain its side, but they have yet to hear from the company.
We've been trying to get in touch with them, pero nagmailap din ang GCash. Hopefully, ay before the end of this week, magpresenta na sila. Kasi nagbibigay ng may ultimatum, either they collaborate with us or we just go the normal way and file the cases.
Technology lawyer Oliver Xavier Reyes says GCash is still safe to use as a digital wallet, but the company needs to exert more effort to restore public trust.
These financial institutions, they invest way more resources, way more money than we could in our own individual capacities do so in protecting our own physical wallets, or perhaps, you know, hiding our money in safes, in personal safes. You know, financial institutions invest way more money, way more resources in protecting, essentially, in protecting our accounts. Transparency in dealing with the situation, making sure that, you know, conveying to the public that there's been no cover-up, for example, that that indeed, you know, whatever may have truly happened, had indeed happened, and they would, you know, that cooperating with our law enforcement.
Tech journalist Art Samaniego believes GCash is not liable if the users themselves gave away their mobile personal identification number or MPIN.
Walang pananagutan ang GCash kasi kahit anong gawin mong pagprotekta sa sistema mo, kung ang tao mismo ang gumawa ng ikakapahamak niya. May mga tao kasi lumapit sa akin, sinasabi nila na nahack daw yung GCash at insider daw to. Well, meron ng inside job dahil sa nangyari. Kasi sigurado sila na hindi sila na-fish o hindi sila naloko na mag-click ng mga links. Nung tinignan ko yung mga ginagawa nila, tinignan namin yung saan ka nagpunta, ano ang ginawa mo, nakita ko na nagpunta talaga sila sa mga site na hindi sa GCash. Mukha siyang GCash, kinopya mismo yung itsura ng GCash, tapos hinihingi yung MPIN, yung number, parang kinopya talaga yung GCash kung paano ka pumasok sa GCash. So ibig sabihin nito, sila mismo ang nagbigay ng information nila.
2022 data from international cybersecurity company Kaspersky show it had blocked more than 52,000 financial phishing attacks targeting Filipinos. A survey by the same company, however, also showed that only 25% of Filipino respondents had cybersecurity applications or programs on the devices they use to access financial applications and services. Meanwhile, the National Privacy Commission signed a Memorandum of Understanding with DITO, Globe, and Smart to better protect their subscribers' personal data. Commissioner John Henry Naga says the agreement is crucial given the increasing instances of data breach and cyber threats. Meanwhile, East West Bank, one of the financial institutions which received funds from unauthorized GCash transactions this week, says it has put on hold a substantial amount of funds relating to the incident and is now cooperating with the investigation. But it is still unclear exactly how much money was involved. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. banners the better-than-expected first-quarter growth number, 6.4%, saying a strong economy will mean more jobs and opportunities for businesses. While this clip is the slowest in 7 quarters since the pandemic, it is still faster than Indonesia, China, and Vietnam, and better than the 6.1% estimate. Meanwhile, House Ways and Means Committee Chairman Joey Salceda reiterates his call for government to undertake a so-called spending catch-up plan to release funds faster for more projects next quarter. Salceda notes real growth in government final consumption expenditure came in at just 6.2%, below the general economy and below household consumption. He adds the private sector again is carrying the day, but warns this sector may be very sensitive to interest rate fluctuations. The Philippine Labor Department sees a need for a balanced solution to the proposed measure seeking a 150 peso daily wage hike in the private sector across all regions. Labor Secretary Bienvenido Laguesma also assuring Filipinos the agency is not sitting on wage hike petitions, saying the Regional Tripartite Wages and Productivity Board has been actively assessing the proposals.
I want to preempt also what the Senate committee would be coming up. The important thing is that they recognize the need for a serious consideration. Mm-hmm. The fact that they created, approved a technical working group is mm-hmm. to me an indication that they also recognize that there is a need for them to look at a balanced solution.
For the Employers Confederation of the Philippines, members of micro-industries may not afford the proposed wage hike. Its president, Cedio Ortiz Luis Jr., says many businesses have yet to recover from pandemic-induced losses.
For me, it's like squeezing blood from stone. I don't think they can. Even their weekly or monthly salary, they have a problem meeting it. Labor market, we have about more than little over 50 million workers. This includes government, this includes those underemployed. Only 16% of them are affected by wage increases.
At present, the National Capital Region has the highest daily wage rate at 570 pesos for non-agriculture, while the lowest is at 316 pesos, also non-agriculture, for the Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao. The Philippine Economic Zone Authority reports it approved 20.6 billion pesos worth of investments for the month of April. That is up 163% and nearly double total investment approvals for the whole first quarter of the year. These include 14 new and expansion projects in Baguio, Cavite, Laguna, Batangas, Cebu, and South Cotabato. 7 of the new investments are in the logistics sector, 4 in export manufacturing, and the remaining in IT, or information technology. In all, these new pledges are expected to generate over 2,000 new jobs. This brings total investment approvals for the first 4 months of the year to 33.094 billion pesos, nearly double the amount from the same period last year. That's a total of 60 new and expansion projects. The country's investment promotion agency earlier said it's targeting to grow investments by 10% for 2023. Power distributor Meralco bracing for higher demand through June. It says the peak electricity demand so far this year has already been reached last May 8. Meralco assures its customers efforts continue to secure enough power reserves.
Based on historical data, there's always pressure for electricity rates to increase during the dry season or between March to June because of higher demand, which basically affects the cost of supply. We've been ensuring that our supply portfolio is adequate at this point that we're expecting, as I mentioned, higher demand. And part of our sourcing strategy is to try and obtain electricity both from our bilateral contracts and from the wholesale electricity spot market, where we also procure our supply at the least cost possible given the situation on the ground.
The utility giant earlier announced a near 18 centavo per kilowatt hour rate hike for May. In other news, the Philippine Civil Defense Office pegs the damage caused by the Mindoro oil spill from end of February this year to be at around 700 million pesos. Now, this already includes losses from the tourism industry, expenses out of OCD's operations, and aid given by the Social Welfare Department. The agency says accidents like this can be prevented if they have enough equipment, such as the remotely operated vehicles or ROVs.
Wala tayong sariling ROV, yung remotely operated vehicle. Based on an informal survey, yung ginamit na ROV dyan para makita yung eksaktong sitwasyon sa ilalim at pag nakita mo yung sitwasyon, magkakaroon ka ng suggested solution. Pero bago tayo nagkaroon ng ROV dun sa ilalim, naghintay tayo ng mayigit halos isang buwan eh. So ang dami na ng damages na nangyari. So napakalaking bagay na mayroon tayong sariling kakayanan.
All right, we are showing you live video now from Muntinlupa City, where former Senator Leila De Lima earlier was present. She was acquitted by the Muntinlupa Court in another drug case. Again, Muntinlupa City Regional Trial Court Branch 204 has acquitted former Senator Leila De Lima in one of her remaining drug charges. She is now free from 2 out of 3 cases. De Lima now awaits the resolution of her pending bail petition from Branch 256. The verdict actually stemmed from a case alleging De Lima and former Bureau of Corrections officer in charge, Rafael Ragos, used their authority to extort money from high-profile Bilibid inmates to support her senatorial bid. She was accused of receiving 10 million pesos from inmates, but Ragos later recanted his accusations against De Lima. He claimed that he was threatened by then-former Justice Secretary Vitaliano Aguirre, who denied the allegation. The former senator had been detained for 6 years already.